I hope you have seen all of these videos. Now let's recap what we have seen. How does a computer work? We will supply some input, computer does some processing, and some meaningful output is generated. How this processing is going to happen? This processing is done by the processor. So processor or central processing unit or microprocessor, I will use these terms interchangeably. Microprocessor is given because of that micro size. So this processor is capable of doing two kinds of operations, if you remember. Arithmetic operations such as addition, division, multiplication, subtraction, and other hand, logic operations such as AND, OR, NOT, XOR, and relation operations such as less than, greater than, equal to, not equal to. These are the different operations possible by the microprocessor. First, we will have a look at the microprocessor and then we will continue this discussion. 4004 is the oldest microprocessor produced by Intel Corporation. And this is famous 8086 microprocessor. These are the few newer microprocessors, old microprocessors, but newer than this microprocessor. And the present modern microprocessor might look little similar to this microprocessor. Coming back to our input process output logic, how this value is accepted by the computer? To provide an input value, first we need to get the approval of the CPU. Inside the CPU, there is a unit called control unit, CU. So this unit will produce a control signal when the CPU is ready to accept the input signal. So when the control signal is available and input is ready, that value can be fed into CPU and the value can be stored either in the register or in the main memory. The stored value in the register or memory can be used for further processing, and after the processing, again the output is stored into a register or into the memory. After temporarily storing the value in register or memory, then the value can be transferred into the output device such as monitor. This is a in-depth illustration of control unit. Control unit has instruction parsing ability and control logic. So there are three different important buses inside a computer. One bus is called as control bus. This will transfer all the control signals. Another bus is address bus. It is used to pass the memory addresses between memory device and the microprocessor. And one another important bus is data bus. This is used for transferring the data. Okay, back to operations and instructions. There are varieties of operations. These operations can be specified using an instruction. So instruction will be having two important parts. Ideally, instruction is going to have two parts. The first part is called instruction code. Instruction code is also called as operation code or op code in short. So the first part is operation code and the second part is operand. Op code and operand, these are used to specify a instruction. So instruction looks like this. So instruction is specified in the machine level language. So the first part opcode is here and the next parts are related to operands. So in this instruction, there are three operands. Instructions, instead of specifying in the machine level language, we can specify in the assembly level language. Opcode specified in the assembly language looks like this. This is called as a mnemonic. So this instruction is having opcode and the exact three different operands. Let's imagine you are going to design a microprocessor. What are the most important things to keep in mind if you want to design a microprocessor? There are three different things. First one is the data handling capability. How many bits can be processed concurrently by your microprocessor? Let's take this example. A microprocessor can process 16 bits parallelly, 0 to 15, 16 bits parallelly. So then this is a 16-bit microprocessor. This is the first part. How many bits can be processed parallelly? The second part is about the instructions. How many instructions you want to have? Depending upon the number of instructions, you need to specify bits for operation code. If you want to have about 16 instructions, you can have 16 bits for opcode. And the remaining bit can be used for addressing the memory. So using 12 bits, you can generate 4096 unique addresses, 4 kilo addresses. Or these 4 kilo addresses are of 16 bit size, because our microprocessor can take 16 bits concurrently. And using 4096, you can address 16 different locations, 16 unique bits. Hence, it is 8 kilobits of memory. If there are more than one operand, that operand need to be specified in the subsequent byte. Regarding our processor design, we have decided how many bits can be processed parallelly. That is one criteria. Second criteria is number of instruction. Third criteria is number of registers. The memory locations need to be accessed using special instructions. To access directly some data, we need to have registers. So processor is capable of storing and retrieving data directly from a register. Hence, you need to have at least one register in your microprocessor. So this is the simplest design. This processor is capable of having 16 bits, and there is one single register. That register is called as accumulator or AC. All the modern processors have accumulator register. And this processor is having some opcode, few instructions, and they can be specified using varieties of opcodes designed in these 4 bits. Let's take this design to a further level. So instead of specifying addresses directly, you can have two addressing modes. If you want to have two addressing mode, in opcode part, you can reserve one bit separately to indicate the addressing mode. You can have one bit to indicate two addressing modes. Now, in this design, you can have, this is the first addressing mode, direct addressing. This is the second addressing mode, indirect addressing. You can see here, instructions are specified using this is the opcode part and operand part. Opcode part is further divided into two divisions. First part indicates the mode of addressing. Second part indicates the operation code. This is a very simple add instruction. Add instruction is essentially is going to add two values. So where are the two values? One value is specified using the address, this address. Another value is assumed as it is stored in the accumulator register. So what this instruction is going to do? This instruction is going to fetch the value from this location. This is the address. This is the addressing mode. Addressing mode is 0, hence direct addressing mode. We will just go to this addressing location and then we will fetch the operand. So now we have one operand. Another one is there in the accumulator. We will add this operand value to the accumulator and we will store that result back to the accumulator register. So this is how one instruction can work in the direct addressing mode. Our main intention here is to understand the direct addressing. You can directly specify the address of the operand. Another addressing mode is indirect addressing mode. Here in the first bit, you can specify one to distinguish from the direct addressing. This one indicates it is in the indirect addressing mode. What is indirect addressing? You are going to specify an address. 300 is specified. If you get into 300 memory location, you will get another address. This is 1350. This is another address. So if you go to this memory location, you will get the operand. So here, what we are going to specify, it is an address, but this address is referring to another memory location. Hence, this is called as indirect addressing. So in this memory location, we will get the operand, the similar operation as that of this B. You will get the operand's value, you will get the accumulator value, you will add together and store the result back into the accumulator. So what is important here? Indirect addressing. You can specify address, and that address can specify another address. From there, you can fetch the value. So in this session, we have seen what is a microprocessor, what are the instructions, how they are specified, what are the ideal two units in the instruction, operation code, operand, and how we can simply design a microprocessor. This is a simple microprocessor design example. And if you want to learn more about this microprocessor, there are very interesting resources. This resource is prescribed by your syllabus, Morris Manu, Computer System Architecture. This is used for your first unit. There are varieties of other resources available in the internet. Feel free to try many of them. Thank you.